All right, Pastor.
Hey, my brother.
Yes, wonderful, wonderful. Okay, we're looking good. Good to go at the top of the hour.
Yes, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the James Galliard Show with Pastor James Galliard.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. It's Monday, February 12th. This is the James Galliard Show, and I am your host, James Galliard. I am thrilled to have you joining me today. Listen, want to shout out. Today, we're talking politics, culture, news, sports, religion, like we do every Monday for this hour. We're on Choice FM. I love ChoiceFM.com, 92.1 FM on your dial. It's the People Station. I'm talking about all the things people tell us not to talk about, religion and politics and culture and all that good stuff. And so today, I've got a good show, I think. I'm going to talk a little Super Bowl. Today, I'm going to talk about what's going on in Durham Public Schools and what's going on in public schools in general. I'm going to give us a Black History moment. I'm going to talk a little bit about early voting, and I'm going to do what people didn't think I had the courage to do. I'm walking through my ballot, and I'm going to tell you everyone I'm voting for and why. And then I want to talk about the most recent church shooting that happened yesterday. So, again, I'm glad you're joining me. Let's jump right on in. Super Bowl talk, y'all. Super Bowl talk. First of all, the only time I'm going to tell you I told you so is when I told you so. And so I want to tell you, I already told you who was going to win the Super Bowl. And so I want y'all to join in as we talk about this. Before we jump in on Super Bowl, because that was at the end of the day on Sunday, y'all know I'm a preacher, so I need to know what your pastor talked about. And so type it on in or give me a call. Listen, this is a call-in station, it's a show. And so I love to get your call, 919-872-9210, 919-872-9210. If you're calling from the 252-937-7400, would love to get your feedback on things. Yesterday, I preached about lessons from a midlife crisis. I'm doing a series on relationships and situationships, and so if you're watching on YouTube, if you're watching on Facebook, go ahead and type in what your pastor preached about yesterday. And go ahead and give him a shout out, whatever church you go to. I'm a pastor of Word Tabernacle Church, and I'm grateful for those folk, and I'm grateful to be with all of you. After church, I got comfortable, and I went home and prepared to watch the Super Bowl. I watched as the Kansas City Chiefs won their second consecutive Super Bowl with a 25-22 overtime win over the San Francisco 49ers. And so before we get into the details of that game, I want to talk about some reasons why folk really log into the show, onto Super Bowl. And that is, first of all, about the halftime show. So what were y'all thoughts about seeing Usher and Alicia Keys and Jermaine Dupri? I need to say, now listen, I'm an Alicia Keys fan, so I enjoyed the short time that she was on. Some people were kind of shouting out, saying that she must have been on the praise and worship team in the morning because she had that frog in her throat. But I think people just being a little too picky. I really appreciated this show. Interesting how on these halftime shows, those who are performing these halftime shows, they go right into their ticket sales for the tours they're about to begin. And so, of course, Usher did that, and I hear ticket sales are booming for him. But I thought he did a good job. I need to confess, I don't know a whole bunch of his music, but I thought he did a good job. I enjoyed him. I enjoyed Alicia Keys. I was a little mesmerized by the wardrobe of Jermaine Dupri. I found myself kind of like, ooh, okay, that's a little different. But overall, I enjoyed the show. I have to say, though, I am amazed by their ability to turn around a show so quickly during halftime. Like, that that kind of blows my mind all the time. I mean, they get a whole situation set up and broken back down. I can't imagine the number of people required to be able to pull that off. And so what were your thoughts? What did you think about the halftime show? Who'd you enjoy? And who would you like to see in future years as it relates to the halftime show? But the second thing that people check out when it comes to the Super Bowl are the Super Bowl commercials. I want to give you my winners and my losers, okay? You tell me what you think. I enjoy the BET MGM. Now, sports betting is about to be a thing here in North Carolina. The General Assembly approved that in their last session. I remember debating that when I was in the North Carolina General Assembly in the State House. But it's going to be a thing. As a matter of fact, early March. And so in our March show, I'm going to talk about sports betting. But there was a sports betting commercial by MGM. And it had the tagline was basically Tom Brady can't play because Tom has won enough. I really thought that was a little catchy. I thought that was cute. So I'm going to give him a shout out for that. The other commercial that I'm going to shout out is the Dunkin' Donuts commercial. Now, and I'm going to have to try to see if I can get Dunkin' Donuts to be a sponsor on this show after I shout them out, because I'm a Dunkin' guy, not a Starbucks guy. And so this Dunkin's commercial I thought was really clever. I was amazed this year of, like, the star power of the commercials. So you had Matt Damon, Tom Brady again, and then you had Ben Affleck showing up supposedly at his ex-girlfriend's spot, J-Lo. And so really, really clever. I enjoyed that commercial. The Temu commercial, the whole shop like a billionaire, I wasn't feeling that. I don't think anybody needs to be shopping like a billionaire who isn't. That's a whole nother shout out. Popeyes, The Wait Is Over, which was about their wings, I didn't think that was a very well done commercial. I'm not a big Popeyes fan anyway. Hope I don't lose my black card when I say that. And then there was this He Gets Us commercial that actually aired last year on the Super Bowl. And I'm going to have a whole segment in upcoming weeks around the controversy attached to the He Gets Us commercials. For those of you that don't know, it's basically about Jesus, but there is a real argument around who is the us that is being referred to. And I want to talk about that in a future show. And then there was a bad commercial for a good product. Now, you know, every show I always say, good afternoon to everyone except. So last week, you know, it was good afternoon to everybody except people that put sugar on their grits. Today, I'm shouting out everybody, shouting out good afternoon to everyone except folk that use Duke's mayonnaise and not Hellman's mayonnaise. And so there was a Hellman's mayo commercial. Anyone who knows me knows I am a Hellman's mayonnaise user. I don't trust deviled eggs, and I don't trust potato salad that's been made with Duke mayonnaise, that's been made with Kraft products. I want Hellman's mayo. And so I'm giving you that for a free tip. You want some better deviled eggs, you want some better potato salad, use some Hellman's mayo. And so there was a Hellman's mayo commercial with Mayo the cat. It was so silly. And they have too good of a product to be fooling around with that kind of foolishness. And so this is just my Super Bowl shenanigans as we start the show today. This is James Galliard, and this is the James Galliard Show. I'm live every Monday from 5 to 6 on Choice FM. If you want to listen to us on the internet, ilovechoicefm.com. You can listen to us live on the dial at 92.1 FM. It's the people station, and it's where I talk about all the things that people don't really want to talk about. And so we're talking about the Super Bowl right now. You can call in. I'd be happy to take your call. If you're calling from the 252, it's 252-937-7400. 252-937-7400. And if you're in the 919, all my Raleigh and Durham folk, 919-872-9210. And so I want to say something else, though. I was not surprised by the outcome. I thought it was an outstanding game. I do like Patrick Mahomes. I'm a Chiefs fan. I'm not crazy fanish, but I enjoyed him. I felt like Andy Reid had more experience and would, at the end of the day, I told y'all last week, if you'll remember, told you last week that defense wins Super Bowls. And sure enough, we saw that play out, as it wasn't a terribly high-scoring game. Let me say something else, though, about the Super Bowl. Whoever is running Joe Biden's Twitter page needs to be fired. Whoever is running President Joe Biden's social media page on X, I guess it's the former Twitter, needs to be fired. They post a crazy picture of the president with his eyes all... Did y'all see this? Picture of the president with, like, his eyes glistening, almost like they almost look like fire almost. And the caption of the X post says, "Just like we drew it up." As if there was a conspiracy, if you will, that the Chiefs were always going to win the game. And given the turmoil, the toxicity, the just how ludicrous people are in still believing the big voting lie that Trump has spewed, we did not need to give people fuel for the fire. I just didn't think that was a good idea. Really disagree with that. Whoever's idea that was, I just don't think that was a good idea. And so I really wish they had not posted that. You know, they went on and on. People just jumped all over the page. "This is why I don't trust sports. I knew it was rigged. This, that." And so for all of those conspiracy theory, lunatics. I mean, they're just, it's crazy that grown people can actually think the president stole the election. But for him to say, "Just like we drew it up," as if this thing was always rigged and planned, it just was not good media, in my opinion. While we're talking about the president, though, let me just say this. Let's not get into the theory. You know, I'm going to get into the ballot in a minute, but let's not get into the whole propaganda around, because of his age, he should not run for president. I don't think it has anything to do, and I'm going to vote for Joe Biden if he's the Democratic candidate, and I'm going to be all the way in. I'm going to talk about some of why in a minute. But understand, it's not his age, y'all. I did a little research in prepping for the show. It's the fact that he looks so frail. It's the fact that it seems like he's having a hard time grabbing understanding. But it's not that he's 81 years old. Because listen to this list of folk. Morgan Freeman is 81. Chuck Norris is 81. Jack Nicholson is 81. Al Pacino is 81. Nobody's fussing about their age. How about this? Martha Stewart is older than the president. Martha Stewart is 82 and run with Snoop Dogg. So clearly it's not age, right? It's people being concerned about how frail he looks, and just his cognitive ability. And I will admit that that is a concern, and I hope that we'll be able to get all that addressed. And as we see him in front of us, we'll be more and more confident about how he appears and how he looks. Hey, y'all, this is James Galliard. Welcome to the James Galliard Show. I'm live every Monday in studio. I want to shout out Doc, who's on one side of the studio, Aunt, who's on the other side of the studio, and together, they hold me together, and I'm so appreciative. Today, I'm talking about Super Bowl. I'm talking about Durham Public Schools. I'm talking about Black History Moment. I'm talking about early voting. We're going to go through the ballot, and then we're going to talk about the recent church shooting. I'm going to take just a real hot break, and I'll be right back with you. And when we come back, we're going to jump into a conversation about public schools, particularly Durham County Public Schools. I'll be right back.
FM.
The smell of your perfume.
James Gellier Show on Choice FM.
Hey, my good people, welcome back. This is James Gellier, and welcome to the James Gellier Show. Listen, I want to talk about public education for a moment. I want to talk to us about public schools and public education. Since we were together last week, Durham County Public Schools have had quite the conundrum. Since we were together last, Durham Public Schools literally had to close its doors for a couple days because their entire transportation support staff called out of work. And so for those of you that are listening from the Durham and the Raleigh area, I'm raising this because I think it speaks to a deeper issue with public education. And so the Pascal Mubanga, I remember when Mubanga was the superintendent of Franklin County Schools before he became the superintendent of Durham County Schools. Pascal Mubanga is a great guy, a great educator. He wound up resigning as a result of all the things going on at Durham County Schools, and the school board in Durham County has appointed a former superintendent of the Wake County Public Schools as their interim superintendent. And so her name is Catty Moore, and Catty Moore is a member of the State Board of Education. She's been in public education like 35 years. But the whole issue is really around funding. It's around what we pay people, right? And so the school board came up with a couple of options in terms of how to resolve this issue. Let me share a couple of the options with you. One of the options was they were going to stick with the plan from January. The plan from January was that all classified staff, and I'm going to get into classified and certified staff with you in a minute, would be given a 4% raise from the state. However, they would not get credit for their out-of-state or private practice experience, right? So that could inadvertently, could adversely affect their pay. So listen to that again. We'll give you the raise, but we won't give you credit for your out-of-state or your private practice experience. So I can see why that would be hard for them to accept. The second option was an 11% raise, and the 11% raise would be a 7% from the district and then 4% from the state. I'm going to get into their whole state versus local funding model in a second, and then they would restore the 2022-2023 salary steps. Option three is to eliminate the compensation study altogether that got conducted by the consultants, and they will provide their employees with a 15% raise compared to last year's salary. And then option four, again, will be to eliminate the compensation study and imply them a 15% salary increase. But that option will restore the salary steps. And so Durham County Public School employees are, they're either classified as, they're either classified employees or they're certified employees. Their classified employees are like, their physical and occupational therapists, their transportation workers, like their mechanics, their supervisors, their drivers, their building services, ground crews, cafeteria workers, custodial staff, all those are classified employees. And then you have their certified employees, which are their teachers and their speech language pathologists. And I'm raising this, although I know all of my audience is not in Durham, I'm raising this so that I can keep in the forefront of us the severity of the public education crisis in North Carolina. Can I say this in the microphone clearly? We need to place clearly the blame of our current public school systems of the on the Republican-controlled North Carolina General Assembly. The blame strictly goes to them. Listen to the data, and I'm not giving you emotion. I'm giving you data. I'm not giving you, oh, well, he's a Democrat, so he's saying that stuff about Republicans. I'm not giving you that. I'm giving you data. The data is the national average for per pupil payment. How much per student is given to educate a child? The national average is just over $15,000. $15,446 is what it requires on a national level, on the average, to properly educate a young person in public school. That's the national average. Now, there are 51 states that are a part of this study, right? You have the 50 states you always think about, and then D.C., right? So that's where you get 51 states from. Now, listen to this. in the state of North Carolina, this is where our General Assembly claims we have a surplus budget. First of all, I just do not like when they say we have a surplus budget, because that means that there's nothing. Surplus means I've spent all I can spend. I've handled everything I need to handle, and I still have money left over. We don't have a surplus budget because we still have funding that we have not allocated, that we need to allocate to properly fund our schools. Listen to this. Out of 51 states, North Carolina ranks 48th. Did you hear me? Think about the great community college system we have. These great 58 great community colleges. I think personally we have the best four-year collegiate system in the country. I mean, we really do have outstanding state schools. And they're reasonably priced considering what an education costs you outside the state. And with that kind of, and we're two consecutive years, we're number one as a business environment. And with all of that at the background, we are 48th out of 51 on per pupil funding. Our funding is almost $5,000 less than what the national average is. $4,655 less than the national average. Our funding, I told you that national average is just over $15,000. Ours is $10,792. Part of the, and this is my struggle. Y'all know how I feel. And people don't like this about me, but that's okay. I care about every student. I care about students that are in public schools. I care about students that are in charter schools. I care about students that are in private schools. I care about students that are in religious institutions. Either we're going to care about children or we're not going to care about children. And if you are an advocate of the voucher system, the opportunity scholarship system, and you are not willing to advocate for children and teachers that are in traditional public schools, then something is wrong, that you only care about the child in your academy, that you only care about the child in your charter school, and you don't care about the 85% of kids that are in public schools, traditional public schools. So my struggle with this is that we are still operating in a school finance system that was established. Are you ready for this? Our school funding model is over 90 years old. We have been funding public education the same way for over 90 years. Now, I'm going to put a pin in that because we got to pay some bills. And so I'm going to go to commercial break. And when I come back from commercial break, we're going to pick up where we're leaving off right now. We're talking about our schools being 90-year-old, operating under a 90-year-old funding model. I'm James Gaillard. This is the James Gaillard Show. And we'll be right back.
The James Gaillard Show on Choice FM.
Come on, folks. Come in. Try Seafood Grill Restaurant, located at 8204 Tryon Woods Drive in Cary. Come get some amazing food combos. Either way, you'll like it, grilled and fried.
What month is it, Dad?
It's February, Black History Month. Don't you know that? That means you didn't. Look at the clock over there and tell me what time it is. We got to go over here to meet Doc Meadows.
The long hand on the 9, the short hand on the 4.
What time is it?
13 o'clock?
13 o'clock. Where you get that from?
I added the 9 and the 4 together, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13.
No, sir.
14 o'clock.
Come on, we got to go to meet our man.
You want to get the other clock there with the lights on that I can see that one?
I don't.
I think that granddaddy clock broke that.
I think we need to go talk to your teacher or somebody when we leave meet our metal.
No, Dad.
One more question. You get it right, I'll forget about it. You get it wrong, we going to the school. What college did Dr. Martin Luther King graduate from?
I'm going to be in the car when you get ready, Dad.
He graduated from Morehouse College in 1948 with a bachelor's degree in psychology. Happy Black History Month.
I was going to say that, Dad.
Meet our metals, 280 October Lane in Enfield. During the entire month of February, we're buying scrap and paying you cash on the spot. Call 252-883-1598. MEDOC Metals, Enfield.
AURN News.
I'm Jamie Jackson. In a setback for Democrats gearing up for the 2024 election, a recent Gallup report indicates a significant decline in their lead over the GOP within the African American community. Over the span of 3 years, the Democratic advantage has shrunk by nearly 20%, posing challenges for the party's reliance on black voters. Now, according to the Gallup report released this week, 66% of black respondents identify or lean towards the Democratic Party, while 19% align themselves with the Republican Party. The report highlights a noteworthy trend in the political landscape, indicating that Democrats continued to enjoy greater popularity among non-religious Americans and residents of larger cities. On the other side of the aisle, Republicans appear to be making gains among religious voters living in smaller towns or rural areas. For AURN News, I'm Jamie Jackson.
Imagine it's the last ride, but your symptoms of irritable bowel syndrome with constipation, or IBS-C, are taking you for a ride. What should you do? Keep managing your constipation with belly pain the same old way? Or try getting ahead of your symptoms by talking to your doctor about treating it with Linzess, linaclotide. Linzess is a prescription medicine that treats IBS-C in adults. It's not a laxative. It's a once-daily pill that helps you get ahead of your symptoms. It's proven to help you have more frequent and complete bowel movements and helps relieve overall abdominal symptoms, belly pain, discomfort, and bloating. These symptoms were studied in combination, not individually.
Do not give Linzess to children less than 2. It may harm them. Do not take Linzess if you have a bowel blockage. Get immediate help if you develop unusual or severe stomach pain, especially with bloody or black stools. The most common side effect is diarrhea, sometimes severe. If it's severe, stop taking Linzess and call your doctor right away. Other side effects include gas, stomach area pain, and swelling.
Imagine what could relief from IBS-C mean for you. Talk to your doctor and say yes to Linzess. Learn more at linzess.com or call 1-800-LINZESS.
The James Gellier Show on Choice FM.
Hey, my people, I'm back and I'm on my soapbox around public education, but I'm laying it down with facts. Because I want us to be knowledgeable people. Oftentimes we become so emotionally connected to an issue and then we get dug in about how we feel or don't feel about something. And at the end of the day, we really have a hard time justifying and authenticating and verifying why we feel the way we feel. Today, right now, I'm talking about the issue going on during public schools, the outgoing superintendent has left, resigned, and there's an interim superintendent as they begin to begin the process of a new search for a superintendent. And the many of the support staff, support workers, are very disgruntled. And the entire transportation department literally just had a call out. And that was last week. This was before we were together last week. And since we've been together last week. And, I mean, listen, you got to realize somewhere like 80% of all of the students in Durham Public Schools require transportation. But when we consistently underfund public education, let me tell you what has happened. So our funding model is 90 years old. What do you know that's 90 years old that's still working as well as it did at inception? I mean, think about it. What do you know? I mean, can you imagine driving a car around? Well, you couldn't drive a car around 90 years old, but can you imagine an ice box 90 years old? Or what? I mean, there's been so many iterations of things in 90 years, and the fact that there has not been an iterative process around public education is part of the reason it is failing. And so understand what the current system is. The current system puts the responsibility on the state to fund the instructional expenses, which also includes personnel of our 115 LEAs. LEAs are local education agencies, right? Like your county school system. So I'm in Nash County Public Schools or Edgecombe County Public Schools or Wake County Public Schools. That's your LEA, okay? And so we have 100 counties, but we have 115 LEAs because in some situations you have multiple districts or multiple local education agencies within counties. You particularly see that up in Halifax County. We'll get into that whole conversation one of these days. I won't even let you know how I'm feeling about that right now. And then, so the state is supposed to fund educational expenses that are instructionally related and include personnel. And then the county, in turn, the county government is supposed to provide income or capital expenses. So if there needs to be a new high school built or a new elementary school built. Well, over time, what is beginning to happen is that with more and more regularity, the state is scaling back its payment to the counties, so the counties are required to spend more of its taxpayer dollars to not just fund the building costs, but now to fund the instructional expenses like personnel. I was researching this earlier today, and as of a few years ago, you had now counties funding, in some situations, up to 20% of the cost of principals, assistant principals, and 6 to 8% of their teacher costs, and almost 10% of teacher assistant costs, and 21% of professional instruction and support personnel. So the state is funding less and less, which is why it has a surplus. So it's taking away from the traditional school, and it's giving money to other entities. And because this county now is required to pick up where the state leaves off. Are y'all following me? If you're following me, say you're following me. You know, I'm a preacher. I like that exchange going back and forth. Talk to me, y'all. And so if the county is now doing more and more because the state is doing less and less, then that means that the county has to have the revenue to do more and more, which means the counties that have the lowest property tax values, because their money is coming from property tax for them to be able to fund those expenses, they're not able to keep pace with some of the larger school districts. And so when we begin looking at this conundrum, we start to see over and over again that we've got to change our funding mechanism. We've got to put more weight back on our General Assembly and back on the state so that they are funding at a higher clip the per pupil average cost to educate a child in North Carolina. Literally, we are, if you're just tuning in, we are literally out of 51 states, that's our 50 states and DC, the state of North Carolina ranks 48th. It is deplorable, 48th in funding per pupil spending. And so, you know, Durham County's got some work to do, but listen, all of our counties do, because all of us are struggling with this dilemma, which is why your vote matters, and which is why your voice is your vote is your voice, which is why I want to encourage you to vote. All right, listen. The other thing I want to talk about today. You know what? Let's just jump right in. Let's go ahead and talk about early voting. Voting begins February 15th. I brought my ballots into the studio with me today, and I brought in Durham, Wake, and Nash County ballots. I actually probably should have brought in Edgecombe County ballot as well. I'm going to walk through the ballots real quick, but I want to remind us, early voting begins February 15th. Somebody's typed that in. Remember that, February 15th. I want to encourage you not to wait till election day to vote. I want to encourage you to vote early if you can. Listen, my people. Tomorrow is not promised, right? I don't know. I hope I make it to March 5th, because March 5th is election day. What's 22? What is the number 22? My regular listeners are going to know this. What's the number 22? The number 22 is the number of days to election day. But I don't know that I'm going to make it until March 5th, right? If I'm alive on February 15th, then I need to try to get out and vote. And so there's going to be voting early. If you're in Durham County, there are 7 early voting locations. If you are in Nash County, there are 2 early voting locations. If you are in Wake County, there are 13 early voting locations. I want to encourage you all to get out and to vote. This voter ID now is the law in our state. And so you do need to have a voter identification. And I'll talk a little bit about what, let me tell you what the picture IDs are. You need a picture ID. For example, include but limited to work, and North Carolina driver's license, a driver's license from another state if you're registered to vote in North Carolina in the past 90 days, a tribal ID, a military ID, an ID card from North Carolina or U.S. Public Assistance Office, a U.S. passport, or a student ID with a photo. And if you have questions about that, I want to encourage you to reach out to your local Board of Elections, or reach out to your local party. If you're from Edgecombe County, reach out to Edgecombe County Democratic Party or Edgecombe County Republican Party, whatever party platform you're on. All the races won't be on the ballot. Only the races that are contested. So I want to walk through my ballot with you real quick. I'm looking at my Nash County ballot. I'm going to tell you who I'm voting for and why. And I want to invite you to call in 919-872-9210. Happy to take your calls. 252. Where are my 252 people? 937-7400. I'm going to go through my ballot real quick. At the top of the ballot is going to be, and this is partisan, because if I'm Democrat, you're going to get handed a Democratic ballot, which means only Democratic Party individuals will be on your ballot. If you're a Republican, you'll be handed a Republican Party. And if you are independent or unaffiliated with a party, you'll be asked, do you want to vote in the Democratic primary? Do you want to vote in the Republican primary? And then, of course, in the general election, we'll have the opportunity to vote both Democrat and Republican, right? And so I'm a Democrat, and so my party partisan nominations are on my ballot. For my particular ballot, Joe Biden is at the top of the ballot, and I want to encourage us. I'm going to go top of the ballot down today, but I want to encourage us to go bottom of the ballot up so that we vote the whole ballot, because there is ballot voting drop-off. So a lot of times what happens is people that vote at the top of the ballot, they skip down certain races. And so let's just say there was 100 people that voted at the top of the ballot. By the time you get to the bottom of the ballot, there may only be 81 votes or maybe 72 votes, right? So there's a percentage lag or drop off. So that's why I say vote the top bottom of the ballot up. But for today's show, I'm going to run off real quick some of the folk that I'm going to be voting for. Early voting this week. Of course, Joe Biden is the only presidential preference on my ballot. There's no additional name listed. Then you have the North Carolina governor, and there are five people that are running for North Carolina governor on the Democratic primary. Probably two of them are only two notable names. Those are Josh Stein. Josh Stein is our current two-term attorney general, and Mike Morgan, who is now a retired Supreme Court justice from our state. There's a lot of avenues into the governor's mansion. Usually the avenue in, the road into the governor's mansion, is through the attorney general's office, through the lieutenant governor's office, or if you take the example of Bev Perdue was lieutenant governor. Mayor of Charlotte became governor. From the mayor's mansion in Charlotte. Roy Cooper, our current governor, got there by way of the attorney general's office. I think Mike Morgan is a great guy. I am personally going to be voting for Josh Stein. I'm voting for Josh. I worked with him while in the North Carolina General Assembly. We served together in the governor's task force for racial equity and criminal justice. I'm going to be like the rest of us, really working hard to make sure he gets across the finish line in the general election. But I am going to go ahead and vote for him in the primary. I will say that on the Republican side, you've got Mark Robinson, who's our current lieutenant governor, and Dale Falwell, who is our state treasurer, who are running against each other. It's suggested that Mark Robinson is the favorite in that. It's going to be a hotly contested race between Josh Stein and Mark Robinson in November in the primaries. But we have to work really hard to make sure that hypocrisy and hatred and disenfranchisement is not a part of our state electorate. And we're going to have to work hard to get Josh Stein, I think, across the finish line, straight across the board. The next race that's on here is Lieutenant Governor Rachel Hunt, another Mark Robinson, but that's different. It's a Mark H. Robinson, so don't get confused. And then Ben Clark. I knew Ben well. We served in the General Assembly, but so did Rachel Hunt and I. I'm going to vote for Rachel in that race. I think she'll prove to be an effective Lieutenant Governor. This is a race I'm really excited about. North Carolina Attorney General Santana DeBury, Tim Dunn, and Jeff Jackson. Now, most of us probably don't know Tim Dunn that well, but we may know Jeff Jackson and Santana DeBury. Jeff Jackson served in the state Senate when I was in the state House, and now he's serving his first term in the Congress. He's running because he was drawn out of his congressional race. But let me tell y'all, the rock star in this race is Santana DeBury. Santana DeBury is currently the attorney general in Durham County. The district attorney in Durham County. She is smart. She is fierce. She is fair. She went Princeton undergrad, Duke MBA, Duke Law School. Really, 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 really bright. And I think she's going to be a great, great attorney general. And I hope she wins. I really do. The next race on there is, let me see, North Carolina Commissioner of Insurance, Natasha Marcus and David Wheeler. Natasha and I served in the General Assembly. She got, you can always tell when people do a good job in the General Assembly because the Republicans historically will try to draw them out of their district. They've become very successful at gerrymandering seats, and they did that with Natasha. They drew her into a very hard-to-win district with a very popular Republican, and she decided to go ahead and run, and I think she's going to do a good job. She's 6 years in the state Senate. She's another Duke Law School grad, and so I'm going to be voting for Natasha for North Carolina Commissioner of Insurance. North Carolina Superintendent of Public Instruction, C.R. Kading Eddings, Mo Green, Kenan Crumble. This is a no-brainer. No slant on anybody else here, but Mo Green is by far, hands down, the best possible person to lead our North Carolina Department of Public Instruction. He was a superintendent in Guilford County. He served as the lead counsel. A lot of Duke folk on this ballot. Now I'm looking at it. Glad to have a conversation about that. He served as school superintendent in Guilford County. He served as the lead counsel for Mecklenburg Schools. He was a foundation president and Duke undergrad, Duke Law School, just exemplary human being. And I think he's going to do well in that role, and I'm going to be voting. I strongly encourage a vote for Mo Green. North Carolina Treasurer Gabe Esperanza and Wesley Harris. Wesley Harris is my vote there. This guy has a PhD in economics. He has a PhD in economics. He's a professor at Appalachian State, undergrad degree from Chapel Hill, PhD from Clemson in econ. He's serving now his 6th year the North Carolina General Assembly State House. We serve together in the State House. I think he's just going to do an outstanding job. Supreme Court Associate Justice C6, Allison Riggs and Laura Christine Cubbage. You're talking about a tough decision because these are two exemplary candidates. Allison Riggs has been a rock star for a while. She is sort of a protege, if you will, in my opinion, of Anita Earls. Y'all all know I'm a Anita Earls friend and fan. I just love Laura Cubbage's story. I love her passion. I love the why. I love her why for all my young people. You know, it's Simon Sinek fans, it starts with why. I love her why. I love that at 29 years old, as a single mom, she went to college. I love that she didn't stop there and went to law school. I love that she wound up serving in various legal capacities and working her way up through the bench. It is a wonderful success story. I think she's doing it for all the right reasons, and I'm going to be voting for Laura Cubbage. And then on my ballot, this is not on all of your ballots, but on my ballot is a district court judge, District 8, Seat 7, Mark Osterhout and Alicia Slaughter. I'm actually going to have Alicia on show next Monday. We're going to be talking about her race. I think Alicia is going to do great in that seat, and I'm happy to support and endorse Alicia Slaughter. I hope you will do the same in that district. Then I'm looking at some of your other, if you're in Durham County, and I'm going to read these out, and then we'll take a quick break, and then I'm going to bring us on back and cover two more subjects before we end today. If you're in Durham, you're going to see Durham County Board of Commissioners. You can select up to 5. You're going to see a Durham County Board of Education at large, and you're going to see Durham County Board of Education Consolidated District. And then if you're in Wake County, you're going to have all the races I just rattled off to you. So if you're in Wake County, your ballot is looking exactly like Nash County. This is James Gailiard. You're listening to and watching The James Gailiard Show. I want you to call in 919-872-9210 or 252-937-7400. I Love Choice FM is how you can watch on the internet. I'll be right back after a quick break, and we're going to talk about a couple more segments before we wrap up for today.
The James Gailiard Show on Choice FM.
Yeah! Let's go! Come on! Woo! Everybody!
Can't believe we're going to be out of time soon. I want to talk two more things real quick before I leave studio and leave y'all for today. Y'all, I'm a pastor, and I'm always alarmed when any kind of violence hits our community. And yesterday, there was a shooting at Joel Osteen's church, Lakewood Church in Houston, Texas. And I want to just talk about gun violence. I want to talk a little bit about what happened there. I think because there are a lot of layers to this story. And I want to ask you a question. How would you feel if your church, you walk through the doors of your church and there were metal detectors up? I'm just wondering, like when you go into a public place, I mean, we live in a gun culture now. How would you feel about that? The reason I raise this is because the shooting occurred. The woman had an AR-15 assault rifle. Now, there's layers to this. And what I mean about layers to this is that there was a sticker that said Palestine. And so here's a woman showing up with an assault rifle in a Christian church with a pro-Palestine sentiment. I'm going to get into a whole show, not a whole show, but a whole segment of a show about Israel and Palestine and all of that. So today won't be that show. I'm just giving you the details of it. The other layer to this is she had a history of mental illness, right? And so, you know, this is an ongoing issue about shootings that are occurring in places that in normal American life, people should feel safe. People should feel comfortable. We're seeing an increase in shootings in schools, in grocery stores, in malls, in hospitals, on college campuses, in house parties, and particularly in houses of worship. This is where I want to challenge us, people. Because, look, I'm not one of those crazy, far-left, anti-gun, don't-never-have-a-gun guys. I'm not that guy. I have a concealed carry permit. But I think the gun culture has gotten out of control. What do you think? I think the gun culture is out of control. I want to challenge you with a thought about common sense gun legislation reform Which is another reason why I'm voting Democrat, because the Republicans offer no common sense gun legislation reform. And so I want you to think about this. When the Second Amendment was written on the right to bear arms, the arms they were bearing was a Revolutionary era musket. The musket had one round. An AR-15 has 30 rounds. So do you really think the Second Amendment was written to keep in mind an AR-15? It was written for... So I think everybody should get a Revolutionary musket. Everybody. But everybody can't get an AR-15. No. The Revolutionary musket, when the Second Amendment was written, it could shoot 3 rounds in a minute. An AR-15 can shoot 45 rounds in a minute. And let me leave you with this last one. When the Second Amendment was written as the right to bear arms, the Revolutionary era musket could shoot 50 yards. That means that's half the distance. We talked about the Super Bowl a little while ago. Half the distance of a football field is how far that rifle could shoot. Do you know an AR-15 can shoot 500 yards? That's 5 football fields. So do you really think that the Second Amendment meant that people should be running around with AR-15 assault weapons? Come on, people. There are 5 million of them in circulation. The average gun owner now has 8 guns. And so my prayers are going out to Joel Osteen and his congregation. My prayers are going out to Lakewood Church. My prayers are going out to any house of worship, whatever your belief system is, Christian, Muslim, Buddhist, synagogue, Jews, whoever you are, my prayer goes out to you. But I think we're at some point going to have some honest conversation about common sense gun reform. I would love to hear your thoughts about this. Should there be some type of, I'm not even saying an all-out ban on AR-15s, but I am saying we got to tighten up that regulation a little bit. I need to pay some bills. I'm going to take a quick break, and then we're going to be back with our last session. Our last session is going to be a Black History Moment. Be right back.
The James Gellier Show on Choice FM.
Rocky Mount, a comfortable place to live, a spacious place to live, an easy drive to work and to school, an affordable place to live. Rocky Mount, Nash, Edgecombe, and Wilson County. Truebill presents Kingsway. Kingsway with big 3-bedroom, 2-bath Fleetwood home, just $950 a month. And comfortable legacy home, 3-bedroom, 2-bath, just $850 a month. Apply today at Truebill.com. Click properties in North Carolina. You can rent or buy a home in Truebill's Kingsway of Rocky Mount. Come see us at the office to talk about easy ways of buying your next home. 295 South Kings Court, Rocky Mount. Call 252-886-7615 or 843-887-2084 today. New and late model manufactured homes for rent and for sale at Kingsway. TRUBILD.com. Truebill.com.
If you ever loved real hard, then this is the show for you. Get ready for the Love Hard Tour. Keisha Cole. Trey Songz.
Put your hands in the air if you love this.
Jaheim. And your girl, K. Michelle. The Love Hard Tour. Friday, February 23rd at the Greensboro Coliseum. Tickets available at Ticketmaster. Presented by the Black Promoters Collective.
This is Chuck Johnson, General Manager of WRSV Choice FM. Now, February is Black History Month, and in recognition of Black people's contributions to this country, Choice FM wants to highlight today's Black history makers in business. If you've created a Black-owned business, regardless of how large or how small, we want to highlight your business here on Choice FM during Black History Month. Follow us at I Love Choice FM on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter, and then tag your Black-owned business or Black-owned businesses that you know so that we can recognize them on air throughout Black History Month. Now, if you're old school, you can email me, chuckjohnson9210@gmail.com, and we'll recognize your business on air. And with that, let me plug Choice FM. If you need to advertise your business, feel free to contact me at 252-904-7618 or RicoJohnson at 252-258-6818 for advertising on Choice. Celebrating you during Black History Month. We are Choice FM.
The James Galliard Show on Choice FM.
This is James Galliard, and I am so excited that you are joining me. I hope you'll do that every Monday. This is the James Galliard Show, live every Monday from 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. Who knows? If you're like me, we may even add a day. We're live, though, on 92.1 FM on the dial. It's the People Station. I'm talking about all the things that people don't really want to talk about. Today, we talked about the Super Bowl. Today, we talked about public education in Durham Public Schools. Today, we talked about early voting. Today, we went down the ballot. Today, we talked about a recent church shooting and the gun culture. I want to end our show today on a Black History moment. You know, it's Black History Month, and one of the things that I'm going to do in perpetuity on this show is lift up Black history every show. And the reason I want to do that is because we have an element, a segment of society that's not lifting up our history. I saw a friend of mine's posted. He's in Atlanta, and his children are in public schools in Georgia and Atlanta. And they are going to be reading Hidden Figures. And, you know, Hidden Figures, many of you probably saw the movie if you didn't read the book. It's the story of the Black female engineers and STEM ladies that were AKAs that were very instrumental in the development of the NASA program and the launching of the rockets. And literally, the parent had to sign permission for that child to read Hidden Figures. Because there's that level of that level of effort to try to destroy or try to minimize the history of our nation and of our people. And so I want to lift up a Black History Month moment for you real quick. I want to talk about the ladies that were part of the suffrage movement, those who fought for the women to have the right to vote. We talked about voting today, and people literally fought for that right to vote. And there's a beeping going on. I think we have a fire drill going, so I apologize if y'all are hearing that. I always like to speak to the obvious things that people might be hearing. And so y'all know the 19th Amendment was ratified in 1920. The 19th Amendment gave people the right to vote. But when the 19th Amendment was ratified in 1920, giving women the right to vote, it didn't eliminate certain state laws that still kept people from voting. And it wasn't really until the passage of the Voting Rights Act in 1965 that really everyone had the right to vote or granted access, the full right to vote. So I want to shout out people like Ida B. Wells, who's a journalist and an activist and a researcher in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. In her lifetime, she battled sexism, racism, and violence. She was a skilled writer, and she used her skills as a journalist to shed light on the conditions of African Americans throughout the South. I want to also shout out Frances Ellen Watkins Harper. She was one of the first Black writers to popularize protest poetry. And so when you think about it, 1965 is that not that far removed. I was born in 1965. So the thought that I was born in the year of the Voting Rights Act being passed is just kind of mind-boggling for me. A lot of sacrifices were made, people, so that we could vote. I want to make sure we do that. I want us to remember people like Frances Ellen Watkins Harper. I want to remember people like Ida B. Wells. I want to remember folk like former enslaved Sojourner Truth, who was an outspoken advocate for abolition and temperance and civil and women's rights in the 19th century. She challenged the notions of racial and gender inferiority. And she was just a tremendous orator and a lecturer. One of her most famous lectures was called Ain't I a Woman? And so I want to encourage us to embrace our history, teach our history to our children, model that history. Remember that we are on the shoulders. We're standing on the shoulders of history makers. And it's time for us to be next to make our own history. I want to do a final shout out. I want to thank all of you for joining us today, joining me today on the James Galliard Show. I'm with you every Monday from 5 to 6. Listen, we have at our church Washington Post columnist and author of the 21-Day Money Fast tomorrow, Tuesday, February 13th at 7 p.m. She's going to be conducting a church-wide and community-wide workshop on financial management. We want to teach everyone in our community how to manage their money. It's a free event. I hope you'll show up and join us at Word Tabernacle Church, 821 Word Plaza, at 7 p.m. tomorrow to meet Michelle Singletary, and she'll be signing her best-selling book, The 21-Day Money Fast. Next week, I'm going to talk about principles of money management as one of our segments. I would love to know what you want me to talk about. And so send me an email at pastor@wordtab.net or type in something in the comment section of social media. Call the radio station. We've given you those call numbers and those letters, and so I hope you'll do that. Listen, I'm way out of clock, but I'm not out of content. I'll be back with you next week. Signing out, this is James Galliard. Have an awesome evening.
On Choice FM.
This is
WRSV, Elm City.
Turn up!
Choice.